And I love the promos you used to do against Mark after a while, also, where you call him rigor mortis. It's just the whole, you have the demeanor of the classic funeral parlor person, you know.
It was just a natural thing. There's a kid that works here for the Ring of Honor that I've been talking to this morning. They had to pull me out of there to come in here. What a fan he is of The Undertaker and of that era. And he remembered everything. Dates, times. He knew what time that I said, oh, yes, you know. This guy knows it all. And I was just sitting there just, I can't remember specific dates. I can remember, you know, what the WrestleManias were, da 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 da, but this guy knows it all. The years just go.
But so you went from Dallas working with Eric Embry to WWF working with The Undertaker. And let me ask you about Eric Embry. Tell me some Eric Embry stories. He had unbelievable talent for getting his pasty white, non-athletic body as over with whatever audience was watching as anybody I've ever seen. Nobody, for anybody who's never seen Eric Embry. He's Cloverport, Kentucky boy, bleach blonde, pasty white skin, no discernible muscles at all, no definition, no physique. Okay worker, okay talker, had kind of an annoying voice, but for whatever minuscule amount of fans was watching any given promotion, he could get himself over with those people. He might not be able to draw any new ones in, but he could get himself over in some respect with those people. It was amazing that people could buy into him.
It was just another case of the right time and right place again. You know, we went through all the tragedies, the Von Erich tragedies, but we don't have to rehash those. We've talked about them before, and everybody else has too. But all the tragedies, the company was closing down, and Jared had come in, and here was Eric. I had never met him before. I'd heard of him before. You know, he had tagged with Ken Timms as a fabulous blonde and stuff. He had been in San Antonio, and that Southeastern Wrestling they had there for a few years there, and I had never met him face to face, but another case of right time, right place. He looked like the old traditional, old school wrestler. It was boots, tights, and that was it. And the beer belly, and the dip in the mouth, and what you see is what you got with Eric. And I think I tried to analyze it a few times. I guess it was just the people I just identified with him. Because if you look out into the crowd, that's what you see: the beer bellies,
there you go,
and the dips in the mouth, and the. That was our audience.
And also,
and some of the women, too.
When Eric had the book, also.
You know, I just beat you to the punch.
Yes, the old interview material.
The kids looked like that. They were dipping.
But when Eric had the book, he would overcome 72 heels. He would nip up out of everything. He would be shot with a machine gun and somehow manage to crawl to the corner and survive.
And they bought it. Yes.
And I would watch the shows and I would marvel at your stuff, but I would also watch the shows and I'd marvel at Eric Embry.
Eric lived in the sport auditorium. No.
Ken Mantell's old office or what?
Everywhere. Everywhere in that building. And oh my God, there was rats that crawled through the rafters, you know, and the maintenance
man. Oh, as big as house
cats. Used to shoot them with shotguns. I see him. He'd sit out there with a gun and I had an office there. I'd get there early sometimes. He's sitting out there with a shotgun. What are you doing with a shotgun? I figured he was thinking looters or something was coming in, shooting at rats.